is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a friend and an awesome educator on the show, Anissa Holmes. Anissa, how are you?
I'm doing fine. How are you today?
I am fantastic. Hey, and if you recognize this wonderful accent, Anissa is joining us from Jamaica today. So I checked on Google Maps, and we're sitting here about 2,400 miles apart as we're speaking right now. But hey, it's going to sound like we're just sitting side by side in the studio. How's that sound?
Absolutely.
Dr. Anissa is an awesome friend, and she is an amazing educator. And if you are new to the Thriving Dentist Show, you are in for an amazing treat. If you're a regular listener, welcome back, and you are going to enjoy this episode. I guarantee it. So, hey, what are we going to talk about? Let me kind of frame our discussion to start with. We're going to talk about social media. And we're going to put a whole new slant on it. We're going to talk about the importance of combining content and strategy. Content and strategy. It's been my experience that dentists that are tuned into the social media world will often get one of those right, but not both. And we're going to talk about the importance of getting both of those right. Anissa, how's that sound?
That sounds wonderful.
Hey, I want to give a little bit of background for our listeners if they aren't familiar who you are. You have an amazing background. Let me go ahead and share your background. And so will you keep me honest and make sure I'm telling the truth?
Absolutely.
My grandmother taught me to always tell the truth. And so I want to make sure I'm telling the truth. First of all, you're a practicing dentist. I want to make that statement. That you're not, you know, in the ivory tower academic, you're doing the same thing that our listeners are doing every day.
Absolutely.
Now you're a 1999 graduate of the University of Alabama School of Dentistry. And in fact, you practiced for a number of years in Birmingham, Alabama.
Absolutely.
And then it was, I believe, if I have the timeline right, about 7 years later, about 2006, you moved with your husband to Jamaica. And the strategy was your husband is from Jamaica. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
Yeah, oral surgeon.
That's
and,
right.
And I think he was thinking about kind of where he could go to make the biggest difference in the world. And I think you were drawn back to his home country because the two of you felt like you could make the biggest difference in the world right there in Jamaica.
That's right.
And since then, you have developed a phenomenal practice in Jamaica, and your practice is fantastic. And we're going to talk a little bit about what it's like practicing in Jamaica because you have conditions there that are different than here in the United States. However, we have listeners in 144 countries, so I know that many of the listeners of the Thriving Dentist Show can appreciate the model that you're providing there in Jamaica.
Good stuff.
Yeah, and I want to brag on you for just a minute. I'm gonna use some data because our listeners like data. You are not only one of these people that you know that lecture and speak and educate. You're also a fellow podcaster. In fact, I think we're gonna figure out how to get me on your show as well sometime. I'll introduce our listeners to your podcast because if you like the Thriving Dentist Show, you're gonna absolutely love your podcast. It's called Delivering Wow, and I'll put a link in the show notes for your podcast. So I want to direct our listeners to your show because I know that if they enjoy the Thriving Dentist Show, they'll enjoy your podcast as well.
Thanks. I really appreciate that.
So let's get their attention because I think we might have gotten their attention already, but can we really get their attention?
Let's go.
how about 50,000 fans on Facebook? That's 50,000 plus fans on Facebook. How's that for credentials?
Yeah.
It doesn't get a lot better than that, does it?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, Anissa has through her... through her wisdom and her experience and her content and her strategy, she has attracted over 50,000 fans. And I know that Facebook is one of the most important marketing strategies in your practice in Jamaica.
It is. It has been huge. It's been amazing. And as a result of it, we are, and like you said, numbers, we are getting about 40 or 50 new patients every single month just from Facebook. And, you know, we are a small country, and so there are only so many people. But because of the whole delivering well and sharing our culture and understanding Facebook and understanding strategy to get our message in front of the right people, people who are likely to become patients, you know, we're having some amazing results.
So if you're a listener and thinking, ah, this social media stuff, yeah, it's fun and everything, but it's kind of a time sink. You know, you spend a lot of time on it and it doesn't produce measurable results. I think we're about to turn that whole school of thought on its end, right?
Absolutely.
Because you've proven, these are proven strategies that you've done in your own practice that you can use Facebook to attract new patients into your practice.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Now, I also want to tease our listeners a little bit. Facebook doesn't sit still. They make changes all the time, don't they?
Absolutely.
And in fact, recently, they have had some new rollouts and some new things that all of our listeners need to know about. And if you're going to use Facebook and social media to attract new patients, you need to know about these changes. And you're absolutely on top of it. And we're going to talk about the new rollouts and how our listeners can use the new rollouts and new concepts to advantage to continue to attract quality new patients.
Good stuff. I'm ready.
Hey, let's start. Let's kind of start with a broad overview. I feel like we're preaching to the choir on this show because we've talked about social media. You know, I love social media. I know you love social media. I know many of our listeners do. But just in case we have some out there that are still sitting there with their arms crossed, not sure about it, why do you feel the dentists need to embrace social media in their marketing efforts?
Absolutely. Well, let me say this first. Social media is the new media. This is how businesses are connecting with their customers all over the world. And unfortunately, many dentists are not there yet. And as a result of it, they're not getting the benefits. And so I'll just give an example. I'll go back to the late 1990s when websites were just becoming available. You know, there were some dentists who were really early adopters to getting a website. And as a result of it, they are still getting the benefits of SEO because they were first. And as a result of it, the content continued and people continued to follow them. And they're still first in their Google rankings, right? And there were some other dentists who sort of watched things happen and then they jumped on board. And then there were some late bloomers. And like I said, those early adopters were the ones who really had the biggest benefit. And, you know, fast forward now, social media is the way to go. And let me tell you, there are, and I'll speak about Facebook because that's really the platform that I see dentists using most.
Sure.
Facebook has like 1.6 billion users and 65% of the users are on Facebook every single day. And so to me, you know, there is no other place that you can get that sort of traction to get your message about your practice in front of your ideal patient, you know? And so you can do, you know, Yellow Pages ads, but what happens with that is people have to be thinking about, oh, I need a dentist, and they go to the Yellow Pages or even a website, to be honest. But the thing about Facebook is because people are on it multiple times a day, many times, and it's your ideal audience. And then again, now because of the strategies to actually target and get your message out in their news feeds, it's huge because people are not thinking about you. They're just vegging on social media. And all of a sudden, a really amazing, engaging post pops up in their news feed. And they're like, oh my gosh, and they're interested. And they click on it. And then they like it. And then they go to your website. And then they learn all about what you do. They learn your culture. They see your before and after pictures. And I can tell you, I love when a patient comes in and they say that they heard about us on Facebook, because that means that they know us already. And they're ready to start their treatment today.
You know, Anissa, we have a mutual friend in Jack Hadley.
Right.
In fact, you're going to see Jack in a few weeks at the digital marketing conference in Dallas coming up. And, you know, Jack's a mutual friend of ours. And Jack taught me something that I think applies to what you're talking about here. And that is that, you know, it's the evolving world of media. And you said that social media is the new media. And you're absolutely right. It is the new media. And he said, where you want people to kind of engage with you today is really two places. It's your website. But let's face it, your website provides information, but it's not necessarily the best place to engage. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely.
It can be. You can build a website that's more interactive and more engaging, but it still has some limitations in terms of engagement. But where you really want people to interact with your practice, and these are existing patients as well as new people in your community that are just becoming familiar with you, is on your Facebook page. Because now they can really get to know you. Like you said, when you know a new patient comes to you via Facebook, they already know you before they come in.
Absolutely.
Pardon my enthusiasm around this.
No, it's really cool. I mean, believe me, I can't. When patients come in, we always ask, how did you hear about us? And when they say Facebook, we're like, all right, we're good.
We're good. You know us.
You know us already, you know, and it's really, really amazing.
Oh, absolutely. So let's kind of get in the weeds here. How have you grown your practice using social media and in particular Facebook?
Right. Absolutely. So I actually started my journey in 2010, and I actually was a client of my social practice. And I know Jack really well. He's been to visit me here in Jamaica. And like you said, I'm speaking at his conference in a few weeks. Right. And I started, you know, with his company, you know, with using their content and really understanding the importance of sharing culture. And so we started one Facebook like at a time, you know, but I can tell you what has grown has been the engagement, as well as, and I'm going to say it has to do with engaging this technology and being an early adopter. And we're going to chat a little bit later about what's new with Facebook and why dentists can be the early adopter in this new space that's what's happening. But, you know, I was an early adopter. And so people saw all of my posts in their feeds. I grew my audience. And over time, I kept engaging. I was very, very consistent and giving information about our practice. And so we do deliver a while. Patients come in and we give them an iPad and a Bluetooth headphone to take away the sound. We give complimentary hand and arm massages. We serve, you know, the best coffee in the world to me, Jamaican Blue Mountain coffee, and, you know, gourmet tea and hot chocolate. And people have an experience in the practice. And it's that story that we share on our Facebook page. And people connect with that. It just evokes emotion in them. And, you know, the thing that I think is great about Facebook is you can connect with people on that really emotional level. But, you know, fast forward a few years, you know, to where we are today, I actually started to look at strategy. And I think that was really the key for us to really start to multiply our Facebook fan base. And that was really diving really deep into creating targeted ads around people who were our ideal patients. And so if we were putting money into it, and we use it as a marketing strategy, so we're definitely putting money into Facebook. I spend about $500 every month. And I'm going to tell you, versus other marketing strategies to grow your practice, this is nothing. Like $500 is nothing. But I'm getting a 1,500% ROI on my social media. And it was because we're targeting. And so that $500 goes to the people that are more likely to engage with that particular post.
All right. I want to take just a minute and punctuate what you just said. A 1,500-to-1 ROI.
Right.
I happen to like baseball. I grew up in a little league family, in a baseball family, and I happen to enjoy baseball. And so I like to use baseball analogies. And in baseball, you know, sometimes you get a single, sometimes you get a double, sometimes you get a triple, sometimes you hit a home run. And every once in a while, you hit a grand slam. Oh, and by the way, sometimes you strike out.
Right.
But you know what? 1,500-to-1, that is a grand slam exponential. That's fantastic. We're going to, like I said, we're going to get in the weeds on this. Lookalike audiences. Hey, lookalike audiences are something that our listeners need to know about, right?
Absolutely.
So we'll talk about lookalike audiences. But I really want to, I want to emphasize that you get strategy. It's not just enough to have a Facebook fan page, you know, to have a business page and post a picture of a patient that, you know, maybe I love Jack's, you know, social science. I love those social signs, you know, where it says, I love my dentist, or, you know, they have different seasonal signs. It's not just enough just to post a picture of a patient holding a sign. I mean, that's fun and that's very useful, and it creates a lot of, you know, fun engagement in your practice, but you can really take that and leverage that so much further with the right strategies.
Absolutely. And I'll just give an example. You know, they have a lot of their promotional items that they have. And last year, for example, they had their Floss Like a Boss campaign. Right. And we really capitalized on that. And so what we did was, of course, we had patients who were signing the pledge, you know, to commit to flossing for 30 days. And we were posting that all over our social media channels. We were asking them to share it as well in their social media pages so that it could go viral. And then we did something really creative. And so there is actually a soca song, which is called Like a Boss, right?
Right.
So we actually created a video, and my team, I mean, they were having a ball, and they were, you know, singing like a boss, you know, floss like a boss. And it was so cool. And I can tell you that video went viral, and, you know, we uploaded it directly to Facebook. And of course, you actually do get a lot more traction if you upload directly to Facebook versus linking a YouTube video. So, you know, right. Can maybe talk about that later. But, you know, that was something that people were interested in. It was exciting, you know, and it's that sort of thing, like taking the content that you get and get really creative with it. And, you know, like you said, creating the audiences, we actually created an audience of our patient list, and we put that in their actual feeds mm-hmm. by strategy, and we asked them to share it, and they shared it with their friends, and are like, oh my gosh, look at my dental office, aren't they cool, you need to go there, you know. Yeah. so it's really taking that really cool content and mixing it with strategy to get the maximum results.
You know what I think of the right Facebook strategy, and you are the model of it. You're the rock star of the right social media strategy. I believe that it's like word of mouth on steroids.
Yep. You know, I say the same thing.
It's literally word of mouth on steroids. You know, I tell a story in my courses, Anissa, that, you know, my grandmother, you would have loved my grandmother, by the way, and she would have loved you. She would have absolutely loved you. My grandmother was a gardener. She enjoyed gardening. And if the weather was nice, she was out in her garden. And let's say my grandmother lived in Jamaica, and let's say she went to your dental office. Like I said, she would have absolutely loved your office, and you would have loved her. She would have come home, and if the weather was nice, she would have been out in her garden. And my grandmother loved English tea, and she had a neighbor, Millie. And Millie would have come out within 3 minutes of my grandmother being out in the garden. And over the white picket fence, Millie would have brought her a cup of English tea. And my grandmother would enjoy her cup of tea. And my grandmother proceeded to tell Millie about the fantastic experience she had at your dental office. And she would have told Millie all about you, all about your practice, all about the cool things, all about the cool people. In fact, she would have said, Millie, you need to be a patient there. In fact, I'm going to take you over there right now. Let's go. She would have thrown Millie in the car and literally driven her to your dental office. The same thing happens today. It just doesn't happen in the garden over a white picket fence over a cup of English tea. It happens absolutely. Over our social media networks.
Absolutely. You're right? Absolutely. We're absolutely right. And patients tell me, they come in and they're like, oh, we saw your post and we shared it with our friends and they asked us, and we told them they have to go to your office, you know? So not only are they doing it, but they're excited to tell us that they're, you know, they're our raving fans, and, you know, they're so happy to share. And, you know, again, it's really about first having the culture. And I my podcast is Delivering Well, and I talk a lot about the importance of having an amazing, unique culture, and a culture that's really different, you know, and putting in your systems and building your brand. But again, it's just having your story, being really fun. And that's what people connect with.
You're right. In fact, just a little sidebar for just a minute. When you think of your posts, your Facebook posts, what is the mix in terms of dental posts versus other things?
Right.
You know, I'm using a broad category there. But
no, I understand your question. And it's a really good question, because now that I'm really in this space of teaching strategy, I'm doing a lot of analysis of people's Facebook pages. And dentists are saying, you know, look at my page. Or they're saying, I'm not getting results. And so I'll say, okay, just send me the link to your page and let me take a look. And what I'm seeing is that, boy, too many posts about teeth.
Hey, and let's face it, you know, obviously you and I love teeth.
Right.
All right. And everyone listen to this, you know, podcast. And you know, we can get really granular, you know, and really nerd out on teeth. Right?
Right. Right.
But I'm not the patient. The lay public doesn't have that same orientation.
No, not at all.
In fact, some of it's scary.
No, I can tell you, yesterday somebody actually sent me an image that a dentist posted on Instagram. I hope it's not any of the listeners. But it was like somebody who was placing an implant, and like they had the pilot drill going into the bone, and there's like blood. And somebody sent me that in my private Facebook group, and I'm like, are you kidding me? Like,
no,
seriously?
No, stop.
You know, but it's not those sort of things. It's the engagement. It's those fun things. It's you giving back to the community. I mean, we have a something called Project Smile, where we give a free smile makeover every year to a patient. And, you know, it's those sort of posts of us saying we're doing this smile makeover, having people come back and talk about their experience having been through it. People connect with those sort of things. Us giving back to charity. We had kids come in a few months ago that had terminal cancer and we treated them in our office. It's those sort of things that people connect with emotionally. Again, remember, social media is really about creating emotional connections. People are not going to connect with an emotional picture or connect emotionally with a picture about a pilot drill going down into bone. And so you want to, of course, have before and afters. And I do have pictures of some smile makeovers that I do in my office. And I think that's really important. But there's other ways that you can use it. You know, so for example, we have different services that we highlight. And so one month we may say, okay, this month we're highlighting veneers. And so throughout the month, we may have some educational pieces. We may do some videos. We may put up some patient testimonials, and we may put up some before and after pictures of some cases that we've done. But it's a very minority of the posts that we're actually putting up on our Facebook page.
It sounds to me like in terms of the mix, your mix is more heavily weighted toward culture, experience, fun, symbolic things that are going on in your practice rather than specific procedures.
Absolutely. But you can do some things that are very interesting. And so just talking about strategy, for example, when it's back to school time, that's the time to talk about, you know, teeth or having cleanings done for kids. And so we always create targeted campaigns that are going to parents are going to mothers who live within a certain radius, who have kids within a certain age. And so we are putting up a really amazing post on our Facebook page. Maybe we're doing a promotion to get them a back to school special. And we are paying for an ad for it to be seen in people that are more likely to actually come in. And so that's how you sort of combine that strategy with the content and also the timing of what's going on, you know, in the community at that time.
Mm, I love that. I love the I love the way that you can move from one realm to the other. You can move from, say, you know, content that's about culture, that's about fun, that's about, you know, just things that your practice stands for. And then you can also move into more tactical type posts that have to do with particular treatment and procedures. I love that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I mean, even like, for example, dentures, how many people wear dentures that are in their 30s versus 40s versus 70s? You know, and it's interesting. There are a lot of 60 and 70 year olds that are on Facebook. You don't even realize it, but the stats show it. And so if you're putting up a post about dentures, and you don't even have to have that on your page, you can have it hidden and have it be seen in the news feeds of 60 and 70 year olds. So, you know, do you have it? And you put it out there and you say, do you have, does your denture not fit? We focus on creating dentures that are really well fitting and that look amazing. And again, you just target it out to people who live within your community who are that particular age, and then they're likely to come back. And the other thing you could do is you could actually use your website. So if you have pages on your website that deal with, say, dentures, you can put a Facebook pixel on your website and you can actually retarget them to see those particular people that went to that page. They can actually now see those feeds or those posts in their news feeds about dentures. So you can, I mean, the strategy gets really, really deep.
Oh, and the strategy gets actually very complex.
Yeah, it can.
And
it could be it's actually simple if you understand it, correct. But it's just a matter of learning how.
Well, we're going to help our listeners understand. Right. Absolutely. Hey, but before we do that, and it's all related, you know, to the discussion, you know, I like this question a lot because I think it's something we can all sort of take a step back and evaluate our own behaviors on this one. But the broad question is, what does it take for a dentist to be successful using social media and using Facebook today? What does it take?
Right. Absolutely. So I think that the content is really important. And again, you know, mixing in post about teeth, mixing in post about culture. You can put educational post up there, you know, something that's new in the dental industry in terms of technology. And, you know, some people are on social media because they want to learn news. They want to know what's happening and what's the latest thing going on. And so it's having that nice mix. Again, really just looking at having great content and engaging. Another thing that I see is that a lot of dentists, they don't want to be engaging, which is really interesting because they're like, okay, well, if I have a page, then I'm going to have to keep up with it. Or I have a page and, you know, people are going to send me messages, you know, I don't have time to respond to their messages. But now what you can do is you can actually really create systems. And so even for that, for example, I don't do most of the responses now. I have somebody in my office that does it. All of the responses are actually customized within Facebook. So we can be on our Pages app in our smartphone and we can respond in 2 minutes. And it's a custom response to a question about implants. And there's a library that you can create. So it really doesn't take much time. You know, with one of the new rollouts Facebook has is where actually you can let them know that the business is closed and you'll respond back to them on, you know, when the business opens again. And so there are ways to really work around that. But again, it's really that engagement. I can tell you, I have no problem with engagement. And so if it's 11 o'clock at night and I'm on my phone and I see a notification pop up, I'll respond because I know it doesn't take me very long. And sometimes people come in and be like, I cannot believe it was like 1 o'clock in the morning and somebody from your practice responded to me about, you know, implants. And so that's why I'm here, because if you guys are that responsive, you know, just imagine what you can do for me in terms of solving my problems.
I'm going to be very bold. You were polite about it when you said that, you know, engagement's a good thing. I'm right. going to be a little bit more blunt about it. Is it okay if I do that, Anissa?
Absolutely.
I think doctors, if you are not going to be engaging, don't even bother.
Right.
It's a waste of time. Don't even bother if you're not gonna. If you just think you can post, you know, you can put something up, you know, and just let it, you know, live its natural life and die its natural death,
right.
and not be engaged, you're not gonna get the full benefit out of it. You need to, and you know, I respect your time, and I certainly understand how challenging it is to manage all the demands of a practice, to manage your clinical demands, to manage your requirements as the business owner and HR and team building and all that. I can understand that. But all of this can be done reasonably with a reasonable amount of time by not only yourself, but your team members as well. Anissa, would you agree with that? Am I being too Pollyannic in that? Or do you think it can be done with a moderate amount of investment in time?
Right. So what we did was we actually created a system. So the first thing in terms of engaging, the first thing that we did was we actually, again, we customized all of our responses in Facebook Messenger. The next thing that we did was I actually assigned a team member, and her role is to log into Facebook. And in our practice, we have a lot of fans. And so we get a lot of messages every day. So she actually logs in every hour. But for people who have, you know, 1,000 fans, 300 fans, at first, you're not going to have that many messages coming in. So maybe you can do it in the morning, sure. like first thing in the morning and maybe first thing after lunch, and have a team member just go in. And it has to be somebody that obviously can respond. And you want to have a system for the sort of responses. So that's the reason why I like to kind of systematize it. But you just have that person to respond to people. So people really, really like that. And that's when people start to continue to follow your page. They know that you're going to be there. And, you know, again, Facebook rewards you. And so if you talk about having your posts being seen in news feeds, people who have more engaging pages are people who are going to have their posts be seen organically in more feeds. And so if you're not engaging, you're going to actually have to spend more money to be able to get your posts seen.
Right, right. Can I suggest a title for that person in your practice? And it's a playful one, but I love to use the title social media champion
nice.
For that person on the team. And the reason I like to use that title is that typically most dental team members don't want another job. You know, right. But they all love being a champion. And we use that term quite liberally in our practice. You know, we have a whitening champion, for example. We have a perinatal therapy champion, you know, in our practice. And I love the idea of a social media champion. And certainly the entire team needs to be involved, but it helps to have a quarterback. You know, it helps to have someone that can kind of quarterback that. And maybe she's a response champion. You know, she's responsible for response and engagement or an engagement champion. But love that concept. And I love the way you can leverage your time by helping train your team members to do some of the things that allow you to be doing other things.
Absolutely. Another thing that's really, really good for you when you're trying to grow your social media is to actually use video. And, you know, this sort of gets into the whole realm of all of the new rollouts, but, mm-hmm. you know, asking patients for video testimonials, that is huge. That is huge, because when you can have your patients actually talk about their experiences in your practice, they're actually doing the work to market your practice for you. And, you know, again, systems, I talk about systems a lot. You can create a system for that as well. You know, so like in our practice, patients come in, they're getting the hot chocolate, they're getting the coffee, we're giving them an office tour, we're pointing out our core values, we show them sterilization. So we do the tour. I know you guys do the tour as yep. well, you know, and we do the headphones and the iPads and the massage. So when the hygienist finishes her appointment, she says, "How was your visit today? How was your experience?" And then they'll say it. "Do you have any questions?" And if they have any questions, she'll respond. And then I'll come in. And the first thing I do before I even look at the teeth, I say, "How was your experience today?" And they're like, "Wow, it was like the best ever. I can't believe I had a tour." Or, you know, like, "Oh my gosh," you know. Yeah. And then they get to the front desk. And then the lady up front is like, "How was everything today? Was everything fine? How was your experience today?" Again, we keep using that word experience. Right. And the patient is like, "It was amazing." And then she'll say, "Do you mind if we take a quick video so that you can share your experience with our other patients so that we can use it in social media, et cetera, et cetera." And the patient's like, "Absolutely. This was the best." I mean, and if you ever hear the testimonials that come out, it is amazing. And we share those videos. We boost them with ads. We do all sorts of things, because this is the sort of thing that really gets people interested. Again, it evokes emotion, because written word is just, you know, auditory. And, you know, some people learn that way. Mm-hmm. Some people learn by listening. So people are listening to podcasts. But when you have video, it just evokes everything, which is really, really huge. So if you're not getting into video, you need to start.
Well, I'll again punctuate those comments, Anissa. So I happen to be a student of NLP, neuro-linguistic programming. And NLP has a variety of different elements to it. But one of the things I teach about NLP is the way people use their senses to process information. And of course, if we have all of our senses, we use all of our senses to process information, but we'll tend to lead with one dominant sense. And so people in the world, if you study NLP, are either visual, auditory, or kinesthetic. They're either visual, auditory, or kinesthetic. The visual people, of course, love to see things. The auditory people process information primarily by listening. And the kinesthetic people are the touchy-feely people. They're the ones that like to have tactile involvement. A good example, Anissa, of a patient that is a kinesthetic is, have you ever handed a patient a model? Maybe it's an implant model that shows how, you know, the implant is attached. And they get totally engaging in it. They can't wait to fiddle around with it. They actually want to touch it and feel it and fiddle around. Have you ever had that happen?
Absolutely.
Have you ever had the opposite of that happen, where you hand someone a model and they treat it like a hot potato and hand it right back to you? Right. That patient's not kinesthetic. Right. But statistically, 75% of the people in the world are visual. 75% of the people in the world are visual. 15% are auditory. And the auditory people are the ones that tend to do well with reading something, you know, because they're in their mind, they're hearing it, you know, they're reading it. And only 15% of the people in the world are auditory by their lead, by the way they process information. And only 10% are kinesthetic. So the video element applies to 75% of the people in the world out there.
Right.
So you're missing it if you're not including that. Hey, let's transition to these rollouts, because you and I both know that Facebook just introduced a whole bunch of new rollouts and new changes. Can we spend a little bit of time talking about them and how they impact dentistry?
Absolutely. And I can tell you, I am really, really excited. And these rollouts just happened just days ago. I mean,
this is fresh. This is, in fact, I'm actually going to be publishing this immediately because of the timeliness of the information. So we're going to actually publish, of course, as you're listening to this, you now know it's published, but what you're hearing is extremely fresh. This just, the ink is still wet on these rollouts.
Absolutely. So let me tell you about the rollouts.
Please.
So the first thing that's happened, which is huge, is that Facebook is now allowing live streaming directly in Facebook. And this is called Facebook Live. Now, Facebook Live actually was introduced in August, and it was introduced to influencers and celebrities. But now it's available to everyone. And I can tell you, this one is huge. And we've been testing it. And I can tell you, the first day that we used it, I had, after five hours, I had 300 people that viewed that video. And this was without it being boosted. This was without any ads.
That was just
or
organically.
Anything.
That was just,
organically. And a few days later, I actually went on live. And how I used it is I went on and I talked about why it's so important for you to replace missing teeth. And so I spoke about that, and I actually showed pictures from my website, an x-ray of what happens, how the teeth shift, and I also showed, you know, replacement options. So I spoke about that. And let me tell you, in one day, it was viewed like 1,300 times. It was shared 11 times. It went viral. It was huge. It was huge, 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 huge. And, you know, that came out just, you know, now it's available to everyone. And it's going to be changing even more. So they're going to have where people can actually send a notification to their friend to actually go ahead and go on the stream. There's going to be the new reactions of Facebook that have just been published about a month or so ago with the ha-ha and the sad and the hearts and the likes. Those you'll be able to actually have people doing while you're actually going through the stream, and that will be seen as well, which is, again, engagement. There's going to be filters, and there's going to be doodles. So they really are incorporating a lot of the other social media features like Periscope with Twitter and Snapchat, and they're making it into the one, you know, encompassing feature for Facebook. Now, this is why it's really huge. Those things are great, and the streaming is great. But what I think is really amazing about this in terms of dentistry is that once this video is complete, once the stream is finished, people can actually continue to comment on it and they can share it. And so these videos, again, we spoke about video before, but these videos can significantly go viral. And I mean, to me, that's the huge, huge thing.
Oh, yeah. Hey, let's camp out on that particular live stream that you did on the importance of replacing a missing tooth.
Right.
How long was that video?
Right. So what I'm doing now is I'm actually testing, and the other Facebook strategists around the world are also testing to really find out what is the ideal length of time for a stream. And what we're seeing is that they're actually giving us analytics now. And so it will let you know, okay, well, at, you know, this particular point, you had the most people come on. But what I say is that you actually have to stay on for a little while, because at first people are not knowing that you're on. And so once you actually go on live, people get the notification, then they jump on board. And so,
see, this is different. And the reason I wanted to go down, I wanted to sort of drill down on this is different than a YouTube video.
Oh, yes.
We know that a YouTube video typically, and correct me if you feel differently about this, Anissa, because I think there are some different schools of opinion, but typically shorter is better on YouTube. Right. So if you could do something in 3 minutes as opposed to five, three is better. And even better, if you could deliver that same message in maybe a minute and a half, that's better yet. But when you're doing live, it takes a little while for people to jump into the stream. And so it's a different, I'm going to use the word medium. That's probably not the right term, but it's a different medium. It's a different level. And I'm glad that you're learning the analytics behind this, because pretty soon you're going to have a lot of science behind you that says this is what we've learned.
Absolutely. And like I said, because it's a stream, what happens too is that people are able to comment while you're streaming. And so, for example, if I'm doing that post about replacement of missing teeth, I can say during the stream, does anybody have any questions about what I'm discussing? And people can actually start asking questions while you're on the stream. So it's a live Q&A session. And so I see dentists using this to, you know, I used it the other day to do a tour of my reception area. And I actually titled it why we serve Milo in our dental practice or something like that. And so that was a really catchy sort of description. And so I started off, and that story leads back to a patient on Facebook that said that he loved coffee and tea, but he didn't drink those. He drank Milo. And we responded back, you know, the next time you come, you're going to have your Milo. And of course, all of this played out on Facebook, right? But we actually did this Facebook Live, and it said, you know, why we serve Milo. So we started with the image of that, and then we focused on our coffee and tea bar. And then I gave them a description of the office. And then I sort of explained to them what this new streaming thing is all about, because people don't know what it's all about, you know? So people were asking questions. I have a coffee table culture book that we made on Shutterfly. So I was like flipping through the pages and going through all of the things that we do. And again, all of this is on video. People are watching, and then people start asking questions about what they see in the book. It's really, really cool, you know? So you have this engagement, and then you're asking people during the stream, you're saying, if you like this video, again, you know, it's going to be coming where people can actually share it immediately. But right now, once it's finished live and it's on your stream or on your Facebook page, people will be able to actually share it. And so all of those questions are all in the history there. It's really, really big. And like you said, it has to be a certain amount of time. And you know that some people are going to jump on, some people are going to jump off, and that's okay. Like, so this strategy, like you said, is very different than YouTube, which ideally you want to really capture, get to the meat of the information and get off. Right. This is going to be a little bit different.
Yeah. A lot different. Let's talk more about some of the other rollouts and things that dentists need to know about that's brand new and fresh.
Right. Absolutely. So there's some other things that are happening. And like I said before, we spoke about this earlier, video is going to be huge. And so when people are in their smartphone right now, they are seeing the Messenger tab in the center position at the bottom of their phone. Mm-hmm. However, that tab is actually going to be moved, and it's going to be replaced with a video tab, and it's going to be a discovery tab. And so Facebook is investing a lot of money right now into video, and they're going to give that video tab prime real estate. And that's why I'm saying, you know, we spoke about earlier in the show about the importance of getting in early. And that to me, you know, this whole video thing is huge. And the reason why right now, and I'll just say this is really important, and then I'll get back to the other rollouts. This is an opportunity for you to be the early adopter. Right now, all of these streams are getting prime real estate in people's news feeds. They're putting it to the very, very top. And the reason why is that they want users to engage and to share and to get really hooked on this new feature that they have. And as a result of it, you know, the businesses right now, we're not having to boost anything, and we're getting all of this visibility for our business. We're able to do Q&A sessions, you know, and all of these things. And it's being seen in everybody's news feed. So this is like when I got in early with Facebook in 2010. That's what's happening right now with video. And so when you're doing these streams, it's going to be seen. They want people to see it. It's at the very top. But what's going to happen, I can predict, is that as, you know, as people continue to use this and businesses see the benefit, they're going to start filtering, and fewer people will start to see it organically, and you're going to have to start paying for it. So right now, the key is to get in early, because when you are on the actual stream, you can tell your audience to subscribe to my feed. So every time I come on live, you're going to get a notification in your phone that I'm live. Tell people to subscribe. And even after it goes, it's no longer live and it's in people's news feeds, people can still subscribe. And once you build up that subscriber list, no one can take that away, you know? So now it's really important to be, you know, an early adopter, and it's really, really big.
I want to comment on that too, with an analogy. This whole idea of being an early adopter and first mover advantage is enormous. And, you know, years ago, about when you were graduating from dental school in 1999, 2000, it was kind of, the public was becoming highly aware of cosmetic dentistry. You know, if you think about the Extreme Makeover TV show and what Dr. Bill Dorfman was doing, you know, on TV back then. And a lot of dentists, or a limited number of dentists, I should say, not a lot, but a few dentists took advantage of that. And they would take out a full page ad in a city magazine. You know, here in the United States, most large cities have a city magazine, a Phoenix magazine, Los Angeles magazine, Austin magazine. And dentists would take out, the wise ones would take out a full page ad in, say, Austin magazine in the year 2000. And they would talk about cosmetic dentistry, and they'd have a beautiful after photo of a patient they had done, you know, beautiful cosmetic dentistry with. And that became a very, very, very effective strategy. But in virtually every case, by the way, I don't recommend that today. The world's moved on, you know, from that strategy. But my point that I want to make is that the dentist in Austin, Texas, it happens to be a client of mine, that took that first mover advantage and placed the ad in Austin magazine, benefited immensely. It got to the point where, you know, 2004, 2005, 2006, there were 30 dentists in Austin with full page ads in Austin magazine.
Right.
But who continued to get the major benefit of that? The dentists that moved first, because they were branded, they were recognized by those readers. They were recognized by, you know, the target audiences as being the authority on that. And the same thing's happening here. It's a different, I'm not suggesting you should do full page ads in your city magazine. In fact, don't do that. But instead, move to where the new media is, where the new marketing opportunities are today. And you really want to go out and you want to grab the brass ring and gain that first mover advantage. And you all have the opportunity to do that. If you're listening to this, you have the opportunity to do that right now.
Absolutely. And another thing that I think that I'm going to start doing in my practice is you can actually create an event in your Facebook page. And in the event, you can actually talk about that you're going to be discussing ortho treatment or whatever treatment
adult,
that you want.
It could be adult orthodontics.
It could be there anything. Mm-hmm. Whatever your topic is going to be, you're going to be talking about, you know, the age that a child needs to go to an orthodontist, or you're going to be talking about, you know, crowns or whatever you're going to be talking about. So you can actually create an event in your Facebook page where people can actually sign up for the event and they'll get that notification when you go live. And so there's so many, you know, you can really put a lot of, have a lot of traction here, which is really, really big. But again, you really want to be the early adopter, and Facebook Live is the way to go. And again, once you're on there, make sure that people are subscribing. You want to mm-hmm. create a really engaging topic that you're going to be discussing, you know, a really eye-catching description. And, you know, again, I'm just so excited.
Can
you tell?
Well, I was going to say that I think between your enthusiasm and my enthusiasm, right. I believe we could generate enough power to light up the island of Jamaica.
Absolutely.
Between you and I. Hey, while we're in the weeds here, would you explain to our listeners what lookalike audiences are?
Absolutely. So I'll say this. I use that a lot. Now, a lookalike audience is an audience that Facebook actually creates, and it's based on pulling data that they have about their users who are very similar to other audiences that you've created. And so there are several ways that you can use lookalike audiences. So say, for example, you have an audience of your Facebook fans. So you can actually create an audience called a lookalike audience. And so they perhaps live in similar locations, similar neighborhoods. Perhaps their kids go to the same schools. They have similar interests. And so the thought behind it is that if people already follow your page, there are other people who don't follow it. And once you start to target them, then they will like your page as well, and they'll be likely to become new patients. Now, here's the kicker. This is how I use it. I actually create a custom audience of my patient list. And so what I've done is I've gone into my practice management software, I actually use Dentrix, and I have pulled an email list of all of my patients. Now, with that, you're able to go into Power Editor in Facebook or Facebook Ads Manager, and you're able to upload that list directly into Facebook and create that custom audience of your patient list. So again, there are times when I want to promote things to my patients. For example, when we're introducing that we're doing the hand and arm massages, I wanted that post to be seen in my patients' feeds because I knew that would be of interest to them, and I asked them in the post to actually share it, right? Mm-hmm. But there are times when, you know, I don't necessarily want to pay for something to be seen in the feeds of my actual patients. But if you create a lookalike of your patients, that is huge. To me, that's even bigger than a lookalike to your Facebook fans, because these people are already your patients. And again, you're telling Facebook, here's my list, give me people that are just like these people. And then you start targeting them, putting ads in their feeds, then they'll like your page.
This is like marketing. This is marketing nirvana. I mean, pardon me, but this is marketing nirvana.
It's really cool, right?
It is so cool.
And then they like your page, and then they start following your feeds, and then they go to your website. So your website needs to be, you know, you need to have a good website as well. And then people go to your website, they see your before and after pictures, and next thing you know, they're a new patient. And you're getting those 40 new patients every month that I'm getting.
Let me go a little further. Let's say, you know, we have a lookalike audience, you know, that has been related to some of the things we've done with dental implants. Next thing you know, you have a new patient. Next thing you know, you're doing a full mouth reconstruction with implants. Right. How's that sound?
That sounds even better.
Well, hey, while we're nerding out, we have a certain segment of our listeners will really appreciate what we're about to talk about. Talk about pixels.
Right. Absolutely. So let me just say what a pixel is, because a lot of people don't understand that. Right. So a pixel is, you can think of it as an invisible box, something that you don't see. And so if you have, for example, an image, a photo that's on a computer screen, it's actually made out of thousands of pixels or pixels. Right. So a pixel is an invisible box that is a piece of code. And so how it works is that you are in Facebook and you're able to create a pixel, and you get that piece of code and you actually put it on your website into certain pages. And once people click on that page, they don't see the code. Again, it's invisible. Once they click that page, then you're actually able to go back and create a custom audience of those people that visited that page. So again, if you had a page that was talking about dental implants, for example, you now have a custom audience of people that have already visited your page. They're not patients. Maybe they don't like your Facebook page right now. Maybe they're just surfing the web and they get there. But now you can start to what I call retarget them. They are a warm audience because they have already had interest in your website in that particular topic. And so now all of a sudden, your post about dental implants start following them on their Facebook page. And next thing you know, they're clicking it, they're liking it, they're coming in, they're doing full mouth, right?
So Anissa, can I share this with you?
Right.
So I just want to show you how this works at a very personal level. Okay. Me. Okay.
Right.
I grew up in San Diego and I grew up as a surf rat. I grew up surfing and I still surf to this day. My new favorite sport is stand-up paddle surfing. So by the way, when I come to visit you in Jamaica, I want you to direct me to the best waves that I can experience stand-up paddle surfing.
Oh, absolutely.
Can we do that?
Absolutely.
But anyway, you know, I'll post like last summer when we were in San Diego, I posted some photos, you know, on Facebook of me, you know, surfing, and I talked about surfing. Guess what starts showing up in my feed?
Yep. They were retargeting you, buddy.
They were retargeting me. And by the way, I got this. So here in the right-hand column is information about wetsuits, information about these really cool hybrid stand-up paddle boards. They're hybrid. So in other words, you can stand up and paddle, but you can also surf with them. One of those is now in my garage. that I bought from that ad on Facebook. Right. And I just loved it. It was information that relates to an interest of mine. And I did a little bit of research and discovered that, yes, that's exactly what I wanted. And now it's in the garage.
Right.
You know, so these pixels are amazing because it allows you to retarget, it allows you to stay in contact with people that have demonstrated an interest in your products and services. And I mean, again, this is marketing nirvana. And I don't know, you know, if you guys haven't figured this out already, Anissa and I are passionate about dentistry. We're passionate about the business side of dentistry. We're passionate about marketing. And all these changes are exciting to us because it allows us to succeed in ways we have not been able to succeed before. I mean, what did we do before Facebook?
Right.
What did we do before the internet? before Al Gore invented them was.
I think you just go. You went with a slow and steady approach. You know, just you know, take it slow on relationships. But now, you know, you can really multiply the results that you're getting by all of these new strategies. So it's really, really amazing and very exciting.
Well, Anissa, I am so happy to introduce you to our listeners, and I know that they're going to want to be in touch with you. I'm going to provide your website where I want to invite all of our listeners to go. It's Delivering Wow, just like it sounds, D-E-L-I-V-E-R-I-N-G, Wow, W-O-W.com. If you're driving, do not take the hands off the steering wheel. I will put the URL in my show notes. And I'd also like to invite our listeners to reach out to you via email. And the email is actually very simple. Connect, just the word connect, C-O-N-N-E-C-T, at deliveringwow.com. So for those of you that up till now have not had a friend in Jamaica,
You have one now.
You have an awesome friend. In fact, I want to really invite our listeners to be in touch with you on a personal level. They need to know you. And so if you're listening to this, reach out to Anissa, send her an email, and just say thanks. Just say thanks. And say thanks for all that you're doing. You've also been kind enough, Anissa, to provide a wonderful guide to our listeners. Could you take a minute and talk about that guide, and then I'll share with our listeners how they can get access to that?
Absolutely. So the guide that we have is actually a Facebook targeted marketing guide. And it's really going to get into what sort of things that you want to post, how you get started. And it's really a really simple guide to help you go ahead and get started with Facebook marketing.
Oh, awesome. And if you'd like to receive that, I'm going to give you a number to text to. I want you to text Anissa's name. A-N-I-S-S-A. So text A-N-I-S-S-A to the number 44222. And again, that's Anissa, A-N-I-S-S-A, to 44222. This guide is amazing. For those of you that think Facebook's just kind of a fun thing to do, this guide is exactly what you need to convert it from a fun thing to do to something that will generate new patients. And again, let me bring this back. This guide very much walks through some of the many things that you did to get to over 50,000 fans on Facebook.
Absolutely.
If you'd like 50,000 fans, just get the guide and follow it, would you?
Absolutely.
Hey, Anissa, coming attractions. You're going to be at the digital marketing conference coming up in Dallas with Jack Hadley. So I'll put a link in the show notes for those that are listening to this and might want to go to hear you at that conference. And then I understand that soon you'll be coming out with a really cool course. And I'd like to have you back on the show to sort of provide a Reader's Digest version of some of the things you're doing on the course. Would you be kind enough to come on back on the Thriving Dentist Show?
I would love to. That would be great.
Awesome. So stay tuned for that. And, you know, you'll want to get on Anissa's email address so you can be informed of all the cool things that she's doing. There's certain people in dentistry that you just need to be in their sphere of influence. People like Gordon Christensen. If you're not on Dr. Christensen's email list, get on Dr. Christensen's email list because he only sends things out that are of value to you. Anissa is another one of those people that I just consider to be dental information royalty. So get on her email list and you will be in touch with her and you'll benefit immensely from it. Not the least of which is that she's passionate about dentistry. She's passionate about helping patients and she's equally passionate about helping you develop a practice that's absolutely rocking in 2016 and beyond. Anissa, let me take a minute and just say thanks. Thanks for all that you do. Thanks for your wonderful friendship. Thanks for your warmth. I always love communicating. Whenever I communicate with you on social media, I just feel better. Hey, on that note, let me go ahead and wrap up our show for today. This has been an amazing interview, and we sure appreciate all that. I love what I do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but I try to remember I couldn't do what I do if it wasn't for you. Thanks so much. I'll look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.